Yes, I've done it before, and now it's time to do it again. Obscure Systems Showcase, back by Patreon request, but this time with commentary for what it's worth, a bit more freewheeling and off the cuff than some of my more recent stuff. Let's hope it all goes well and dive into some PC88 games. The PC88 series was about the biggest 8-bit home computer line in Japan during the 80s, aimed at a broad market and falling into a similar sort of niche as the Apple II, C64, ZX Spectrum, you know what kind of thing I'm talking about. It wasn't really built with games in mind, but well, that wasn't going to stop anyone. This version of Xevious, well, it's not all that thrilling, is it? It doesn't play any better than it looks, believe me. Published by Enix, yeah, the Dragon Quest guys, well, not their finest hour. This port of 1942 is a bit better. Yeah, it's pretty jerky, but well, it looks okay, doesn't it? And it plays okay too. A pretty typical 8-bit port of the era, not a million miles away from what you'd get on the Speccy or CPC or all those. We probably shouldn't be surprised because this was a pretty typical 80s home computer in a lot of ways. A Z80 based processor, beeper sound to begin with, 64 kilobytes of RAM, though it did have a generous 48k of video RAM too. The most commonly used graphics mode in games was 640 by 200 with 8 colours, which could be, well, a little ugly at times. Fairly high resolution though, a common feature of Japanese machines from early on because of the need to be able to display those complex kanji characters, giving it all a distinctive look. This version of Ghosts and Goblins, or Makaimura as it's called in Japan, being a prime example. Not the finest port of this game, but well, it is playable. By the time this particular version of the game came out in 1987, the PC88 line was capable of better things. Later models had improved graphics and sound, but still a lot of developers were not really keen to use the new features because they wanted to maintain backwards compatibility. The PC88 line seemed to really suffer when it came to ports. Most of them seemed to be, well, forgettable at best, and some of them, being forgettable, would be an improvement. Let's take a look at Super Mario Bros. Special. Oh dear lord, hardcore Mario fans might notice one or two differences here and there from the original, mainly in the fact that it looks, sounds and plays like it was made to harvest children's tears of disappointment rather than be an entertaining game. Yeah, Nintendo never had all that much luck when third-party developers got their hands on their properties. You'd think Hudson Soft, of all companies, might be a safe pair of hands, but, well, no. Were they trolling Nintendo, or was it just a horrible mistake? History doesn't record it, and Nintendo seem oddly reticent to relive this chapter of their past. I can only imagine notorious perfectionist Shigeru Miyamoto's reaction to this one. His face must have been a picture. Perhaps wise underlings just kept the whole thing from him. Yeah, if he asks, just say that Hudson Soft was destroyed in a very localized earthquake. Yeah, what he doesn't know won't hurt him, eh? Well, maybe it was just all part of Nintendo's plan. Maybe it was Nintendo trolling NEC to make the competition look bad. I could speculate all day about how this weeping sore of awfulness came to be, but I think its true origin is probably unknowable. A horror from beyond human understanding, and maybe I should just stop talking about it. Another thing I should probably stop talking about is my Patreon, which I will put a link up to right about now somewhere, and also in the description. If you would like to support me, that would be great. Your help is really appreciated. Okay, back to the games. You could come away with the impression that the PC88 isn't all that exciting if you just go on the names you recognise. A brief trawl through the sort of stuff on offer seems to be pretty slim pickings. This version of Gradius is another one to put in the passable at best pile, though it does sound pretty good. One of the features of the later PC88 models was much improved FM sound synthesis, which a lot of games made use of, often to great effect. But nice noises aside, why on earth should you care about the PC88? Well, when it comes to original titles, stuff made for the system, it does so much better. Thexder here is a brilliant example. Released in 1985, this could be seen as a proto-Metroidvania game. In fact, I do wonder if this could have been some sort of influence on actual Metroid, which came out just a year later on the Famicom Disk System. You might notice that this looks a hell of a lot better than anything else we've seen so far. Well, it does, doesn't it? But this one isn't running on some super souped-up version of the machine. It's just very well done. The PC88 series lacked hardware sprites and scrolling. It wasn't a games machine after all, like I said. But it did have some tricks up its sleeve for people who knew how. Equipped with a speedy for the time 4 MHz processor, it also had its graphics memory mapped into the CPU address space, opening up the possibility of software-based sprites and scrolling not unlike what was common on the Spectrum and Amstrad CPC. Especially the Amstrad CPC, because the PC88 had some architectural similarities with Alan Sugar's Ultraplank, oddly enough. Details of this stuff are, well, pretty hard to come by, but it seems that good coders could push the PC88 to pretty great things. Thexter's sequel from 1989 is just as impressive, maybe even more so, smoother and faster with some nicer looking environments. Both of these games are really quite enjoyable if you're feeling in the mood for what it's fairly old school action game stuff. It's got that hard to quantify feel that the best console games from this era have. And yes, Thexter did end up on the NES as well as other platforms too for that matter, including DOS, but these versions are, well, they're the original and as good as you'll find anywhere. And whilst we're about it, let's look at Wibarm, or Wibarm, I have no idea how to say it, a game that made it to the West in the form of another DOS port, but I really don't think that version had any advantages despite running on more powerful hardware. Wibarm, why is it called that? I don't know, let's not get lost in speculation. Released in 1986, this might have drawn a bit of inspiration from Thexter and a variety of other sources too by the looks of things. A weird hybrid of RPG, shoot-em-up, run-and-gun and 3D dungeon crawler, but it all works quite well and I think you could call this something of a pioneer, a primitive version of today's open-world, multi-layered third-person action games. Flying around in the overworld, you'll be warped into encounters with enemies that are part RPG and part shoot-em-up, awarding you with experience points and other gubbins after you've blasted everything. Morph into another form and explore the ground level and you'll be able to dive in and poke around in some buildings. A primitive 3D world awaits here with what I would guess is some sort of ray casting, but well, I don't know for certain. It does look amazing for a 1986 8-bit game, that's for sure, despite the odd camera angle. I wish I could tell you exactly what you're supposed to do here, but well, I don't know. So let's move on and have a quick gander at Silpheed whilst we're passing. Another game that I'm not 100% sure how to say, but well, I'll try not to let it get me down. This had an international release on the Mega CD system and it got quite a lot of attention at the time. This version is of course not quite visually on the same level, but well, it's still just as impressive when you consider the system it's running on. It looks superb, a pseudo 3D type thing going on, one of the most stylish games on this system, I think. It plays pretty good too, but this is, well, it's unmistakably old school in its design. It's as much Galaga as it is Gradius, but no poorer for it. A space shooter with a lot of abstract alien enemies flying down the screen at you like it's 1982, but power-ups and boss battles that are a bit more mid-decade. The 3D works well, it plays really smoothly, though it is, well, sort of crushing on the difficulty front, but it was the style at the time, wasn't it? Right, moving on, what else could there be? Well, how about R-Type? Hold on though, I thought all the ports on this system were terrible. This looks different somehow. In fact, it looks suspiciously good even compared to the best that we've seen so far. Well, in truth, this is running on the PC88VA, a hard-tuned ultra-powered PC88 for the discerning Japanese home computer enthusiast. Turbocharged with all new graphics modes, a 16-bit Z80 variant running twice as fast as the original. More RAM, better sound, yes, it had it all, or at least a good lot of it. including this, which is, well, one of the very best ports of R-Type only. NEC's own PC engine giving a better showing at the time, I would say. Yeah, this version is as obscure as they come, but it looks fantastic, it sounds superb, and its only real flaw is that it seems to suffer quite a bit from slowdown. Weirdly, it comes with a level select right out of the box, or the version I played did, giving access to those later stages right away, though even without that, the difficulty level seems to have been tuned down a bit on this version, certainly compared to the arcade original, or even compared to the PC Engine version. The PC88 VA was ultimately a total flop. It seems like the ill-fated Apple II GS, but more so, and there seems to have been very, very few games that ever made full use of its capabilities. This version of Shanghai, it looks pretty and, well, it does just about what you'd expect it to. Another game, Shinra Bansho, is a railed shooter in the style of Space Harrier, which is, well, it's technically on point, a very smooth demonstration of what this expanded machine could do, but otherwise fairly bland in both looks and gameplay. Olteus is an interesting shooter RPG hybrid that seems to involve grinding for level upgrades and experience and cash to buy stuff in the shop. It looks stunning really, and it sounds fantastic too. A standout title on this system may be. If, unlike me, you've got the patience to work out what the hell is going on, it might be a really good game. Yeah, this top spec version of the PC88 didn't last all that long in the marketplace. It didn't quite cut it against the competition. Much of it was made by NEC themselves, strangely enough. For games, it wasn't a patch on the PC engine, and if you wanted more power in your computer, well, the PC98 series was the obvious choice. And outside of that, despite its impressive specs, it was still behind the mighty Sharp X68000. In fact, the last models in this line didn't have the extra graphics power at all, though they did keep the faster CPU. NEC must have realised they were not quite on a winning streak. So just one more game to have a look at, I think. The Scheme from 1988. Sticking with the old school 8 colour graphics mode, though it will make use of the extra sound hardware if you've got it. I've already reviewed this a while ago in another video, so I won't go into massive depth, but we'll have a look at my old review if you want to hear more, and I will put up a link somewhere about. A game that, well, personally I enjoyed quite a lot, though it may not be to everybody's taste. A non-linear action adventure game with some RPG elements. Nothing massively unusual, but it's nicely done and worth a look if that sort of thing appeals to you. It's certainly got the air of classic computer games about it somehow, rather than it being a total console-like experience, the kind of thing I could expect to see on the C64 maybe, but well, you know, even then the SID chip can't really compete with the rich soundtrack that this game offers. So I think this is where I'm going to grind to a halt for the time being. I'm going to leave this trip into the less trodden paths of retro gaming for now. I should point out that I'm really not an expert on Japanese home computers and certainly not their software ecosystems. Have I picked out some good representative samples of what was on offer? Well, I have no idea. I have left out those text-heavy RPGs and visual novel type stuff just because I've no idea what's going on, but these were a big part of the scene on the PC88. For obvious reasons, I've also left the adult stuff well alone too, another niche developers on this system filled. If you can think of anything that I should have covered but didn't, then well, I will be genuinely interested to know what that might be, so do let me know in the comments below. So I'll sign off for now, and I'll see you next time for, well, who knows what, but maybe more obscure systems if that's what anybody wants. So extra special thanks to my very generous patrons, and goodbye.